haven't heard much about Ampu so far. We are a strength mode startup. We got started just about 3 months ago. And what we are going to be demonstrating today is basically our first fruits of our effort. And glad to have this, glad to talk at this meetup at CASK, because this was a result of our collaboration with CASK. And if you go to CASK.io, CASK.co, and look at their partners page, you will see an unfamiliar logo called Ampu. So when you go there next time, you would recognize that, hey, it's us, right? Okay, so what I'm going to be talking about, still, we are still in stealth mode. What I'm going to be presenting is our first effort. It's not going to be, I cannot really comment about whether it is going to be the final shape of the product, what the features are going to be in the product, etc. When the product is coming out, that I'm not disclosing. So I am basically doing my marketing talk in the first 10 minutes, where basically I'm going to be talking about what we think is going to happen in this big data place, right? What is our vision based on which our company was founded, right? The second thing I'm going to be talking about, the first version of the product that we have done, which is in collaboration with CASK, is basically accelerating data pipelines, right? So how do we implement data pipelines in particular with CASK? That's what I'm going to be talking about, CDAP, the CASK data application platform. Second thing I'm going to be talking about, the core technology that we are using, which is an open source technology that came out of my previous company, which was Pivot, the open source version of Gemfire called Geo. So that, I'm going to briefly be describing that. And then how we build upon that and how we make Ampu platform work with CDAP. That's the, I'll be giving you a demo. And hopefully I can finish all of that in 20 minutes and then we can reserve the rest of the time for Q&A. I would like to answer more questions in Q&A, right? Okay, so how did we get it, right? The first thing that happened was basically, yeah, all the transactions that were coming in did not actually look like SQL. They basically said, hey, this is my bank account, give me $20 from that, right? That did not look like SQL. That basically came through a request by punching a couple of keys on the radio. And then that got translated somehow into SQL and basically got into the structured data ledger, and you pull data out, right? So the mutable data set that basically was present here, essentially all those transactions got logged into a managed data store, right? And then people wanted to do analytics on top of it. So they took a daily snapshot or maybe a monthly, weekly snapshot of that managed data store, created an immutable data warehouse out of that, at which the data analytical queries, got fired at this immutable data warehouse, right? And then you would basically create views which were sort of, you know, I have done this query on this set of tables there that created a logical view. I want to publish that as a physical materialized view so that the next time I make the same query, it will fetch it from it, right? So that's basically what got us, and then as the apps and data users grew, a lot of transactions started coming in. So immediately the transactions could not be materialized in a managed data set. And therefore we started logging. We basically created a logically structured LSM trees or whatever you want to call it. I mean, there have been like 20 different variants of that. We created the log, and these logs basically got into an append-only file system that basically were stored as a set of files. And then your ETL vendors came in and said, hey, all these set of files, I'm going to do a nightly ETL job and publish structure those and basically push them into your managed data set. And that's where a bunch of people made a lot of money, much of ETL companies made a lot of money, right? So that's basically where we got. And this architecture resulted in this huge big data and app explosion. And you would basically see some of these things in even the Hadoop ecosystem, which is now, in this year, it is going to be actually early next year, January 2016, it's going to be 10 years old. And that's what is going to happen. The second sort of shift that is happening in this new world is, rather than this whole unstructured and structured, and that basically was almost after Hadoop came about, it was essentially a division which was not even required, right? You could basically manage, I mean, there have been like 10 different SQL on Hadoop systems that actually use Hadoop for structured data sets. So why are we still talking about this unstructured being in this world and structured data being in this other world, right? That
division has gotten softer so far. However, the new division is getting created, which is that, hey, your processing frameworks are, you know, exploding. The number of processing frameworks and the amount of use cases, the number of use cases that you can do for various data genres, various computational frameworks, that is the one that is actually creating a divide between the number of processing frameworks and the number of persistence frameworks, right? So processing and persistence are the ones that is actually become the new divider, right? And as a result of that, you basically said, why are we creating this set of files and set of directories and, you know, data sets that are combined within, as a stored as a set of files within directories, why are we treating that as the processing unit? We need to separate the data management unit, data management abstractions as data sets from the data processing units or abstractions that are called data frames, right? And this is where now the data frame as a terminology came out of Python and Pandas, and then now Spark, and a lot of people have observed that. But really, a data frame is a unit of processing, a data set is a unit of management of data, right? That is the division in this entire data ecosystem. Basically, is happening along the processing and the persistence boundaries, right? So, what we want to allow is basically separation of the unit of management of data and unit of processing of data. So, data sets as a different abstraction. How do we get these data sets and process them, convert them into data frames so that they can be processed by various frameworks, various computational engines? That is basically the thing, where the action is these days, right? So this is where we play, which is basically getting those data sets, which are the units of data management, and converting them into data frames. And you will basically see that the number of frameworks, the computational frameworks that have emerged in this layer, is exploding almost every month. A new framework gets announced, right? 10 years ago, we basically started copying Google, saying that, hey, Yahoo basically saying that, hey, HDFS and MapReduce. That's basically what it is. This entire thing was HDFS, this entire thing was MapReduce, period, right? Now with Yarn, you basically saw, hey, suddenly people started deploying multiple data frameworks, multiple data processing frameworks using Yarn. So now we have graph processing engines, we have 10 different variants of SQL and Hadoop, and there is something called Spark. I don't know whether you have heard of it. Has anybody heard of Spark? Okay, something called Spark that basically seems that, you know, we are going to take over everything. But then there's something from Germany came called Apache Flink, and basically people started wondering, okay, is Flink better than Spark? Is Spark better than MapReduce? Do I basically move everything that last 4 years of work of in MapReduce into Spark or next into Flink, or do I wait for the whatever eBay is going to announce next? Right? That basically is the explosion that is happening at this year. This is, and our belief is that the best of breed data engines are going to win. Let them compete. Let them become the best at what they do. Right? We do not care about it. We are going to democratize the access to these data frameworks, data processing frameworks, and separate the persistence from the processing. That's basically where we do. And we have to design for scale-up, because scale-up is no longer the case. It's not going to work out economically or technologically. Right. So this is what last summer, I called a butterfly architecture. If you twist your eyes a little bit, basically sort of looks like a butterfly, right? So this is the butterfly architecture. I think this is the one that is going to be, and this is my firm belief, since at least about a year since I coined this term, that this is the one that is going to be deployed at all the enterprises. And this is where we play. We build the building blocks for building this butterfly architecture at the enterprises, right? So our mission is basically to provide high performance analytics solutions for building real-time customer experiences, right? This is the marketing part. That's where it ends, right? This is where really where Dask and Hadoop and Spark and Flink, all of those actually come together. It's basically big real-time analytics is the requirement of the enterprises. That is where things are going. But it has to be done through a democratic manner, providing all these data processing frameworks the same storage capability, the same real-time analytics capability, through a memory-centric architecture.
which is the way of the future. That's where we want to basically build our products, right? Okay. So what are the kinds of big data processing pipelines that we see in here? We actually talked to a lot of customers when we started this in early this year, and we basically said that, hey, guess what? There are literally four stages if you look at logical number of stages, right? Basically ingestion and ETL. You can use Flume, you can use Scoop, you can use Kafka, you can use Fluentd, you can use 20 different mechanisms to ingest this data. Then there are ETL frameworks. Most of them, you know, a lot of people got started with moving ETL away from the data warehouses and now are implementing with custom code in MapReduce or Hive or something like that. That's where the ETL happens. And then there are analytics. Now, analytics is getting more and more advanced. Linear regression basically gets done in weeks. Set the data in, fit some curve, and that's it, spit it out, right? But now when you go to even the simplest step, logistic regression, it actually has iterations involved, right? So the analytic frameworks, that's where Spark and others who are actually doing these, enabling the iterative computation are actually succeeding. However, the fourth stage, which is actually what is the result of this analytics framework? These are models that can be served, that can be used for serving the users, providing them real-time experiences. That's the API. So these are the four stages in the data pipeline. Unfortunately, what happens today is that after every stage of pipeline, you basically get to the shared storage. And shared storage is today the universal shared storage in this whole big data ecosystem is HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System. So you basically, whatever data you are ingesting, maybe they are from queues or etc. Right? You are getting some events, one line at a time. You have to serialize them, push it onto the disk, into files. Right? The file basically gets to 128 megabytes, so flush it onto the HDFS, start the next file. All those things, right? Those are happening. Then the ETL, again, brings it up from the disk-based HDFS, does some ETL, pushes the data back into HDFS. Then the analytics starts again. Well, unfortunately, you know, the number of connectors and the number of abstractions that are being used for all these data exchanges are not there. So the least common denominator of all these data processing frameworks is a CSV file. So you take all these structured, nicely structured tables, you convert them into CSV files, dump it onto HDFS, pull it back from CSV, create an RDD out of that, dump it out so that HBase can ingest that. And that is all happening with this slow, persistent storage for data exchange. Where we want to get in is basically between the data processing stages and this slow, persistent storage. And we are trying to do that by pooling all the available memory on the cluster. Now, the first thing that you basically say, okay, already my YARN and containers and all my data, you know, Hive, etc., are sucking up all my 64 gigs of RAM, all my 128 gigs of RAM. If you actually use memory judiciously, that is not required. Most of that memory, you should go back to your good clusters and check how that memory is getting used. Most of that memory is getting used for file system buffers. The file system buffers are great if you are reusing them. You are not. You should check that. Again, that has been my experience, right? So we are taking all that unused memory, we are making it available for these intermediate data storage, right, for building this data pipeline. Alright, so this basically we think, and this is our belief, that it is going to be driving performance for exactly the same frameworks that you are using. You do not have to reinvent new frameworks that make judicious use of memory. You can use Hive, you can use Spark today, you can use Kafka, you can use Pig, you can use MapReduce in order to get that speed up when you actually disassociate yourself from HDFS as a data exchange. That is our basic thing, right? So one of the pipelines that I'm going to actually demo, this is just an illustrative example, right? It's a smart meter predictive analytics pipeline. The assumption here is that all over the US, 60 million households, everybody has a smart meter, and everybody is, you know, the smart meter is every second, every 10 seconds, every 15 seconds, it's actually transmitting the energy use that it has made in the last 10 minutes or 10 seconds or something like that. All that data basically gets aggregated at some energy company's site, their cloud, whatever you want to call it. And that data basically gets analyzed to check, okay, what is the energy use going to be in every locality? And we are just splitting it into a mile by mile locations
here, the entire US map is getting split into that. What is the energy requirement for the next hour in this particular location, let's say in Nebraska, right? That's basically what we are trying to calculate based on this entire data pipe. So the data comes in through Kafka or other mechanisms. We are also obviously in the real example, we have not actually used Kafka, we are just simulating the whole data generation process. Then it basically gets, comes with a time order. You have to sessionize it, you basically have to say, okay, per meter, what is across these different timestamps, what were the energy values, energy consumption values. So that sessionization happens. You have to denormalize based on the amount of the metadata that is associated with every smart meter, saying that, hey, this is the smart meter that is installed in Milan's house. He has two kids, he has two, four people that are living in the house. So that's basically the metadata that is actually pretty static. Not suddenly like real time, increasing the population of my home. So that is a pretty static. So that is the static information that you need to join it and denormalize it. And then since the analytics that I'm doing is going to have a lot of iterations, I'm passing that same data to Spark in order to build the predictive model. And once that predictive model gets built, I need to push it to a serving system so that when somebody asks, okay, what is the energy usage going to be in this particular area, I need to get that energy usage from them, right? So even in this simple pipeline, right, you basically see that there are lots of stages and involves three or four different frameworks. And all of them today are basically using HDFS and these CSV files in order to exchange data, right? So this is the pipeline that we have implemented. And as you can see, these are all the tables that are getting generated. We do denormalization, we do sessionizations, we do aggregations, and these are just the four Hive or MapReduce steps. After that, it gets passed on to Spark, and then they basically start to do a lot of predictive analytics, right? So when we initially we implemented this using just MapReduce and just tried it using UZI and some workflow manager to actually run this. However, things the way they are in the entire Hadoop ecosystem, we could not quite get it to run full scale. So we easily. So we actually moved that pipeline and built that using CDAP, right? And this is what it looks like. You can basically see there are a bunch of flows, there are a bunch of jobs. Mm-hmm. Some of those are MapReduce jobs, one of them is a Spark job. That's basically what we did. That was the first time. Right? We got the pipeline running, and I will show you the demo later. But this is, we got the entire pipeline running, and this is all this work, including the product, is a 2.5 months work for 2 or 2.5 engineers, right? So that's how easy it was to build this pipeline on CDAP, right? Our core product is based on an open source project called Apache Geo. If you haven't heard about that, I don't blame you. It's been out there just about for 3 or 4, I would say 4 months, or 5 months now. It is actually a 10-year-old enterprise-grade product called Pivotal's Gemfire that got open-sourced as Apache Geo project, right? So this is not somebody basically just cooking up something in a couple of years and throwing it over the wall and basically making it open-source. This has 10 years of technology behind it, right? It is now open-source. The reason it was built in 2005 is basically because the open source Gemfire developers actually saw, or Gemfire as a company, Gemstone was the name of the company, they actually saw the need for these in-memory data grids, as they call it, started as an object database, later converted into an in-memory data grid, and these days it is actually being used, Gemfire as a product, and which is the product out of the open source Apache Geode, is actually being used for the traveling needs of 1/3 of the humanity. China Railway uses that, Indian Railway uses that. I believe when I left Pivotal, there was a deal going on with Russian Railways that is also using that. So 1/3, 2.5 billion out of the entire people actually interact with Geode or Gemfire, whether they know it or not. Right? It is a classic solid product, distributed in-memory data grid that can be used as a distributed in-memory database if we do the right things to it. And this is the reason that we have actually decided to build our product on top of Apache Geo. So most of the community today is actually from two companies, Pivotal, which originally open sourced it, and Ampul. We have a few engineers already contributing to it. I would really ask you, if you are interested in this kind of space, take a look at Apache Geo and please try to contribute, because this is a great technology that is, you know, already 10 years in the making, and a lot can be done on top of that. And we are actually, I mean, that's a little bit selfish, because we are using it as our core technology, right? How does Apache Geo compare to the rest of the big data stack? Well, the closest in use cases that it comes to is obviously HBase. The HBase is also a memory-centric, although it uses HDFS for the persistent, it's a memory-centric data store, right? So when we just compare it with just the standard YCSB benchmark, 50% inserts, 50% loads, right? 50% inserts, 50% reads, you basically see that even at a small scale, right, at about just about 100,000 rows, you can basically see that Geode is actually built for speed, and therefore it is 3 times faster than HBase, even at that speed, right? Okay, so what did we do with CDAP, right? So first, CDAP, obviously, you know that it uses HBase as its internal table store, right? And so CDAP with HBase is basically just take the exact application. No code changes required to the CDAP application, and we'll be showing a demo make you confident about that. We have just to make 4 configuration changes, right? You basically, CDAP is extremely extensible, and this is the reason that we started talking to CDAP, I think in March or April or something like that, to ask people, saying that, hey, you guys are extremely extensible, how do we embed with it, right? So literally 4 configuration changes, and we were able to do CDAP example that is powered by Geo, right? The 4 configuration variables, you have to change the CDAP data set as an you have to create, you know, like extension directory. That's basically where your extensions are going to be stored. What are the extension modules? That's basically you say that in the distributed mode, use this module. In a single processor mode, use this module. And for a stream processing mode, use this module. That's pretty much it, right? This is the only change that you have to do in your CDAP configuration, in order, and no change required to the application. You can just run the same application on CDAP using Ampoule as underlying platform, right? So I wanted to actually do a live demo, but my engineers won't trust the CEO to actually, you know, not fit up. So I'm basically carried. They sent me a video. Okay. So what I'm going to do. Is run this video. Okay. Yeah, should be. Okay. So this is a regular our SME application that I showed earlier that is running with CDAP with HBase as an underlying, right? That's pretty much what is happening. As you can see, there are a bunch of MapReduce jobs that are running as part of that, and there are a bunch of data transfer tasks that are happening with the flow, right? What we are doing now is basically just running that application using our proprietary shell script. So we are basically doing a data generation. Initially, all this data is getting generated, and then you are basically storing all of that in HBase in the data pipeline. Right? You can basically see that the first data generation state is complete, and now the analytics actually is working. So denormalization stages, aggregation stages, stats, collection, then the spark. So one of the things to note here is that people are basically saying, you know, get your MapReduce jobs, and there is a paper vendor somewhere 2 miles from here, basically saying that Spark is the next MapReduce. Take all your MapReduce jobs, convert it to Spark so that you can get Spark on XYZ distribution, right? You don't have to do all of that. You basically say, hey, this is what MapReduce is good for. This is what I'm going to be using. This is what Spark is going to be is good for. This is the stage where I'm going to be using Spark. And guess what? No data conversion costs. In fact, data conversion happens really fast, because there is no data conversion, right? So you don't have to really say, okay, now I'm going to launch a big 6 months project to convert all of my MapReduce job to Spark. You don't. You basically just say, this is what Spark is good for, this is where I'm going to substitute Spark, right? And then everything else works. So these are the 4 changes that you have to do. As I said, in the configuration only, the application absolutely does not have to change. So now what we are doing is basically we have installed Geode and Ampoule product on top of that, and that basically will stop CDAP in order to get that and restarted it in order to absorb the new the new configuration. And now with the new CDAP installation, we are adding our own app. So the app is now added. We go to the terminals to basically see that when the app is activated, even if everything is stopped, all the tables, etc., that are needed are essentially created. And this is just geo tables. So once we activate the app, basically see all those data sets are actually created, the tables, empty tables are created. And now I start my pipeline. The same pipeline I'm basically starting. And you can basically see all the right number of rows, etc., exactly matching the HBase are created. So basically doing, I'm not going into the performance here. We are doing a detailed performance benchmarking, and those numbers should be coming out as we sort of get to a later stage, later stages. So you might have thought that, hey, maybe we have programmed this application such that it works with both Ampoule as well as HBase, right? That is not the case. We took one of the packaged examples in CDAP, which is the Twitter sentiment analysis. No changes. We basically just said that, hey, these are the tables that are created once you activate that app. Start running the app and you will basically see that. So no changes required, and your Twitter sentiment analysis application. Alright? Alright. The first benchmarking that we did, obviously it was on a very small cluster, so we don't really want to demonstrate this. But as you can see, since Ampoule was designed with performance in mind, we are without making the major modifications to Ampoule itself or major optimizations, we are still faster than HBase, right? In some of our internal benchmarks, and which we will be publishing later, we have shown it to be 3 to 5 times faster than HBase, right? And we'll be doing a lot more tuning and lot more application optimization later. So to close this, I want to basically emphasize three things, right? We definitely discovered that using a framework like CDAP simplifies application development, especially when there are multiple stages that need to be strung together to build an entire end-to-end application. The second one is basically just by pushing in using an in-memory technology in Geode is basically much more faster than the current way of doing things, which is either using HBase or using HDFS or and I think it will be true in most of the cases as long as your working set fits really nicely within memory, which is actually true for 90% of the organizations. You should go and take a look at your working sets rather than the raw data. Again, that's the second action item. And Ampoule basically can show immediate performance gains. I mean, even without a lot of tuning, even today, we can actually show immediate performance gains. In future, what's going to happen? Well, I don't know. We are still in stealth mode. We are actually still learning. And this is the reason that we actually, while being in stealth mode, I'm still talking about it. It's because we need feedback from you. We need feature requests from you. We basically need, if you are willing to do a POC, we can help. We have not yet kept it, for download on our website because we are just alpha right now. But we will be able to work with you in order to, get your applications faster and working in such a nice environment. All right, cool. Questions?
Slides available?
They'll
be available.
Yeah, I will put those slides up. I haven't yet gotten a slideshare account. Fortunately, because of my earlier association with the Hadoop, slideshare account actually belongs to me. So I can actually push that there.
We understand.
That is absolutely correct.
In this
case, the map reduce would perform equally faster.
I can't say equally fast, right?
But faster if it really works on the same.
Yeah, absolutely. That, I mean, the storage layer for all of these is going to be the same. That's our goal, right? I mean, if you think, you know, 10 minutes ago, why does MapReduce, even if MapReduce and HDFS were the only things in the entire Hadoop ecosystem, why does still MapReduce operate on input formats and output formats? Why does it say input directory and output directory? Because HDFS just offers that. HDFS does not offer an input format and output format abstraction. The reason was that those who designed MapReduce at that time were always aware and I think wanted to make it extensible so that, hey, your input format and output format does not have to be on HDFS. Why can't it be in memory? And that's what we are trying to do 10 years later.
So HDFS also knows providing the tiered architecture.
Yeah.
So some of the directories in HDFS you can feed into memory.
Yeah, there is a block pool abstraction in the block pool abstraction in HDFS that says, hey, this is a RAM based, this is an SSD based, this is a disk based, right? And each one of them you can configure differently, etc. However, the interface is still a file system interface. When your disk basically had a 5 millisecond latency, spending time in data nodes and 100 microseconds in data nodes and name nodes, that was acceptable, right? It's a 5 millisecond latency on disk. Now you have a 50 nanosecond latency in memory. Do you really think that HDFS in RAM, which is 100 microsecond CPU wastage of just file system semantics to access a 50 nanosecond cache lock, is that still, you know, the right thing to do? When I talk to people, I describe it that you bought the fastest car in the world and you basically are not using its engine. You're getting two bullocks and asking, you know, that pulling that Ferrari, right? That's what is happening with HDFS.
The RAM actually sounds very similar to like the SQL. You execute the SQL, I mean the amount of time you spend in parsing the SQL all the way to get the data.
Yep.
I mean that's something
absolutely true.
So do you integrate with YARN? For example, while masking is how do you do memory budgeting over here right now?
We are a static service right now. Okay. Right? And we have intentions to integrate it with YARN. Long running services on YARN has had a, I should say, contentious past. Right? There is Llama, there is Slider. All those are trying to attempt running long running services using YARN. We haven't actually spent a lot of time, frankly, analyzing which one actually suits our architecture better, and therefore it's a static service right now. Right. It's basically like HDFS. Right.
But do you see any problem with co-location or something like that in MapReduce?
Co-location happens because we are location aware. We actually expose the location exactly as HDFS.
No, what I'm asking is you have a geo node running and then you're running MapReduce
So based on my experience in last 5 to 10 years working on actual Hadoop users, right? One thing that I see happening commonly is that first of all, people are buying machines with bigger and bigger memory. Right? In fact, I think if I read on Lauderdale's website, they actually recommend 128 to 512 gigabytes RAM per machine these days. Right? Because who knows? Somebody might want to decide running in Mala. So that is it. Right? So what is happening there? Is that because most of the workload is IO bound, right? Because of HDFS and disk inefficiencies, in order to avoid the IO wait cycles and in order to increase the utilization of those machines, CPU utilization of the machines, because that's what the CIO says typically, what people do is basically have oversubscription on the number of cores. So per core, I have seen crazy configurations like 8 containers, YARN containers, being configured per core on a machine. And the reason for that is basically, you just want to increase the CPU utilization by overlapping IO. That's pretty much it. That is the reason. The excessive number of YARN containers is the reason why you are taking up so much memory in your machines. Right? Instead of running just, if you have four cores, just running four containers, you are running 32 containers, each one with a 2 gigabyte, so 64 gigabytes is gone. Right? So that is the reason, that is where all of your memory is going. If you basically speed up, if you remove all those containers, the whole IO8 times from those containers, I think the four containers per, one container per core will be able to do the same job that eight containers are doing. With the same
thing. You're doing the concept of vCores and just say cores.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, so the basic belief here, and this has been proven by the long-term hardware trends, is that writing to local disk is actually slower than writing to remote memory. When Google started building their hardware, and this is the this is 2000, and when GFS and MapReduce were actually designed to work well with those hardware, they were using 100 megabits Ethernet and 100 megabytes per second disks, right? Throughput disks. The disks themselves have gone to be 150 megabytes per second, and nowadays the Ethernet in the cluster is 10 gigabits per second, right? That is the end. So writing to remote memory is faster than writing to local disk, which is where Geode, I think Gemfire took the right decision a long time ago, that in order to do fault tolerance, you basically need to replicate memory, memory-to-memory replication over the network is faster than using the local disk for persistence. That's what we use for fault tolerance. And obviously for DR and for you know, high availability, even when your cluster goes down, we have persistence, but persistence is not coming from synchronous replication. It is actually our disk-to-disk replication. Is actually coming from a single disk, right? And replication across memory. Yeah. We haven't done anything like we haven't done in Ampoule. We haven't changed that. We basically believe in that philosophy, and we basically are using the Geode's replication policies for it.
What's your durability story for how does it actually handle? I mean, you're comparing it to H8, right?
Yeah.
So you're saying that you replicate, you know, yeah, other nodes better than.
Yeah.
Don't you think you probably need twice the number of nodes as H8 to probably show comparable kind of, I mean, at least same level of durability guarantee?
We have same number of same durability guarantee because we are doing asynchronous log. I mean, again, it's I'm not taking any credit for that.
Okay.
Right? It's basically Apache Geode that is doing that.
Okay.
Right? And 800 mission critical customers are using Gemfire, which is the product for Apache Geode, for financial services, for ticketing, etc. You know, all these 800 customers, right? I mean, so I think the durability story is no. We haven't done any changes.
Okay.
We haven't done any changes. But good. Thanks.